derivative is very easy to define now in terms of limits.
Limits.
Something similar. But we'll try to prove all of the facts that you have learned previously in differential calculus. And we haven't done their proofs. So we'll try to do their proofs. So notions of derivatives there. And then we have what you call the fresh element.
Is that from R to R?
From R to R.
So it must be defined on all R.
Sorry.
The domain is whole R.
Yeah.
For D.
I mean, it's like any real value.
D subset of R.
D is a subset of R. So function is differentiable on R. And at x equal to k, where k is a point in domain, if what happens? If this limit exists,
if x minus f of x minus k, x minus f of
x minus a, if this exists, function is differentiable at a point, and we can give it this guy a name, which is f prime of a. That's what the definition is. Something that you understand that you've done before. And I mean, if we can rewrite it basically, if I define h to be x minus a, then I can reshape this definition to be just the same as limit h goes to zero of a plus h plus f of a over for h. This could be something similar. Okay. Do someone has Latin book? Latin book? I've got it, but one page is missing.
Sir,
so
I can give you PDF.
Anyway, now one thing is that when such a limit exists, so we know that such a limit, limit exists, if the left hand limit is same as right hand limit.
Any definition of limit will
like a definition of the limit. So we return back to the case that what does this mean? This means that if you approach from left of zero or from right of zero, you're gonna get to the same number as outcome. And that same number is going to be equal to this.
Can we have epsilon delta definition here? Epsilon delta definition.
We do have epsilon delta definition, but yeah, sticking with
left and right.
Left, right, limit. We did one result basically. And then I don't need to tell you some of examples. Okay, some functions are differentiable, many functions are differentiable, some functions are not differentiable. Again, it's like why this function f of x equal to absolute of x is not differentiable, because you compute the left hand limit, the right hand limit, you're going to have plus 1.
At x is equal to 0.
At x equal to 0, obviously. So it's like on x equal to 0, you have a kind of a kink on a curve actually. Huh? Like, you know, unexpected change. like a king on a curve. That's a king. There, it's like f is differentiable everywhere, but f is not differentiable at x equal to 0. Okay? Okay? And why it's not differentiable? That if you compute plus limit, you're going to have what?
Plus h.
Plus h. Maybe
plus h.
0 plus h plus minus h. 0 over
h.
Over h. If you are bigger than 0, slightly bigger than 0, this absolute of h is going to be h.
H divided
by 1 actually. And what would be limit h approaches to 0 minus? You're going to have 0 plus h minus 0 by h, but since you are on slightly like left of 0, so this absolute of h is going to be minus h actually. So you're going to have negative h by h, and this limit is going to give you minus 1. So you know these left hand and right hand limits, which sometimes are called left hand derivative and right hand derivative. So, like a right hand derivative and left hand derivative. Sometimes you also call that. So they both are unequal and hence this limit doesn't exist. Therefore, the function is not differentiable. Okay? Function is not differentiable. Alright, so there are lots of exercises for you guys, okay? Small exercises like that function is square root of x, so what is this derivative, function is constant, what is this derivative, there are some piecewise functions which you have to differentiate, so just follow this definition and you can do it very easily, okay? The next thing is to move towards some of commonly well-known results. Another quick proposition, and the proposition is that differentiability implies continuity. Okay. Differentiability implies continuity. So if a function is differentiable at a point, then it must be continuous at a point actually. Okay. So this is both something that you have to think of. Okay. So what should be the proof? How should we go actually? What's your suggestion? You know, what we have to do is to suppose f is differentiable at x equal to a, and whenever I will say f, I mean, you know, map from D to R. Okay, so this I want to show the continuity, and for the continuity, what I need to show that limit x approaches to a, f of x must be
f of
equal to the value of the function evaluated at that point. In other words, if you take their difference, it should be zero. In other words, that's what you want to prove it to be zero. Okay, that's what we want to basically do. Okay?
Uh-huh. Ah. Prove it to be
zero. Making sense?
I think it makes sense. Sir, you're okay, sir. You can proceed.
So that's what we want actually.
Yes, sir.
That's what we want. That's what we want. And this is given to us. Now, if this is given to us, what does it mean? It means that, you know, you have this limit x goes to a, f x minus f of a over x minus a equal to f prime of a. Okay? But now, this should be pretty much simple. Why? Because you just throw this on the other side and take limit on both sides. You have limit. So since you have, okay, you're going to have this as limit x goes to a f of x minus f of a equal to x minus a f prime of a. So since x is appearing here, so you need to put also limit here.
Yes, sir.
Okay? But like if you substitute limit here, what are you going to have?
So
f prime of a is for sure a finite number because f is differentiable at a. transmittivity implies differentiability. We have done it already, but that is kind of repeated. And then we can do what we so call what we call the algebra of limit. I'm not going to do it, just prove it for yourself. It's like I can collect these figures and I'll just do one of them, and you know, you can do the rest. So we can do several things. It's like, okay, if we can prove that if alpha is multiplied with a function f and you are differentiating it and evaluating it at a, it should be same as alpha time f prime of a. Okay, so it's like, okay, the second thing is that if you have a sum or difference of primes, you're going to have basically this evaluated at a. So it's like a linearity property, okay? Something that you already know. And then third is basically that, okay, if you have the product of two functions, you want to differentiate them at point A, then it should be what? It's like f prime of A evaluated at A and times g of A plus f of A times g prime of A. And fourth property is that if you have product prime evaluated at A, it should be f prime of A g of A minus f of A g prime of A over g evaluated at A squared. I have something like this, something that I have done. And the fifth property is what do you call something basic, which is just basic, but it's a bit non-trivial. And that is chain rule. And proving chain rule is not an easy task. I mean, you have to work hard for that, actually. Okay.
But in R,
huh?
In R,
you have to work hard for that. Give it a try. Try to do it through definition. You'll be stuck. Okay. It's not as trivial as you think, actually, that okay, you just do something and you easily grab it. So, I mean, if you see from Slotin, it's nightmare. You see the proof from here. Okay? But it's much better than Rudin. Okay. So I'm going to follow from Rudin. But it's fun to think about that, how you can do it from Slotin as well. Okay. So what would be the chain rule? The chain rule states like, okay, so you have these assumptions. I'm not repeating these assumptions. Imagine that you can compose these functions and you want to differentiate the composition of two functions, actually. Like, I'm not writing the assumption. Like f composition g prime a, then this should be same as that you compute the derivative and evaluate at g of a and multiply it with g prime of a. Agree? Should be something like that. So that's what the key basic properties are. Now first two are very easily drivable. Just think about it. If you have this definition, mm-hmm. you're gonna have what? Alpha here. So it's like alpha f of x, alpha f of a, and throw the alpha, and you're gonna have alpha times f prime of a. How about f plus g prime? So it's going to be what? F of x plus g of x minus
f of a plus g of
x. Okay, so you can play around with it.
Sum of limit of sum. Similarly with R4.
Similarly with R4, but okay. The product would be bit non-trivial, because you have to play some trick, but I guess that we also did something similar in calculus 3, so it shouldn't be hard for you to drive, okay? So what should be the definition of FG prime evaluated at A?
Limit.
So it should be limit x goes to A, FG evaluated at, say for example, A plus H. Okay?
Then we
and
H goes to 0.
And okay, yes. So, okay. Should write FG at x minus evaluated at a over
x minus
a at a. And what does this mean? You need to keep one thing in head that here FG does not mean composition. It means that what is the meaning of FG of x? It means that f of x and g of x. That's what it means. Careful what means what. So it's going to be f of x g of x minus f of a g of a over x minus a. So give me the suggestion, what should we do?
Add,
subtract some things, and what should I add and what should I subtract? Imagine I'm adding minus f of a and g of x and f of a and g of x minus f of a and g of a over x minus a.
Yes, sir.
It's like, okay, you can pull out this g of x and the rest is easy. That's just what you just think about it. You can pull out just g of x and f of x minus f of a or x minus a. So this is going to be f prime of x. Okay, and then limit. Then you put the limit,
so
g of prime of a, g of a plus, from here obviously you can pull out what?
F of a.
You're going to have g of x minus g of a divided by x minus a, and evaluate limits, you're going to have g prime of a times f of a. So that's just something pretty much simple. Okay? Give it a try to basically this expression. Now, what we can do next is think about proving the chain rule. Shall I get rid of it? You understood it?
Yes,
sir. So, there isn't anything so interesting. So this adding subtracting trick is very much important. This is going to work for several of such kind of situations actually. Okay.
Sir, can we do the quotient rule by computing first to 1 over g of x, then dot product?
But for that, you need to first prove basically the result for 1 over g of x.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also here, which is that how you can evaluate the inverse of a derivative at a point.
The result in
slot, okay? I mean, do the way you want, but you know, be critical of yourself that don't use anything which you haven't proven.
Mm-hmm.
Don't use the notions that you have learned from previous calculus, okay? So that is not allowed.
Yes.
Okay? I mean, if I have proved first three properties, use them because you have proven them. Okay. Try to prove the fourth. I mean, do it the way you want. I mean, there is no point of. Okay. So, I would like to prove chain rule. I'll just give you a hint, like the rule is giving, okay? And to make more sense, because there is a difference between bit notational difference between Slogan and Rudin. So I'm writing the Rudin's statement here, and then I'll try to prove basically the chain rule for the Rudin case. Okay, so here's the theorem. Here's the theorem which is about chain rule from Rudin. Okay, so for the differentiation, I'll mostly follow Slogan. Okay, it contains all results from Rudin. and additionally contains some more interesting results actually, and exercises as well. The good thing about SWOT is that it contains lots of exercises, okay? So suppose every single bit is important here. Suppose f is continuous on AB, so it's like a function which is continuous on AB, and f prime of x exists. In other words, it exists for every x, so like this. This exists for all x in A to B, so it's like it's fully differentiable. Okay? And then G is defined on I, okay, which contain the range of f. Okay, so like I, so like a G is defined on an interval I which contains the range of f, in other words this f of A B. All of images are in the domain of I, in the domain of G, because we want G to be operated on the value of f.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Gff. Huh? We are in Gff.
Yes. Okay. And obviously I want G to be differentiable at f of x. The values of function basically. You know, obviously on I, but you know, at the values of
x. Yes, sir.
And G is differentiable at f of x for every x in. Okay. Now if h of t is G composition f of t, where t runs between A and B, then one thing is for sure that h is differentiable. Okay, it's differentiable at x. X is an arbitrary point in A to B, and its derivative can be explicitly given as what? It is that g prime evaluated at f of x. Okay, times f prime of x. Okay. So it's like really formally stating the chain rule.
Should we write h of x is equal to g composition f of x?
Huh? H of x.
Yes, we have defined g of
x. Okay. G composition. Okay. Now here is something that is quite important. So if I have been asked, for example, if someone is expecting, someone is asking, then what is chain rule? No, that's not chain rule. That's all is chain rule. So you need to appropriately understand. So that's what the difference between a mathematician and an engineer is. You know, an engineer or maybe someone who is kind of utilitarian, he doesn't care about the assumptions. Okay, assumptions are there, obviously. But, you know, you need to be very careful. Okay. And I mean, if you see, all of assumptions are reflected here, actually, you know, in these two equations. So, why you need all these assumptions? Because you want this to make sense. Okay? You want this to make sense. You just think about it. So if f... So it's like if f is continuous at time, you know, f is continuous at points of B, and the second assumption says that G can be evaluated at f. But then, why we need this assumption that G is differentiable at f of x? Because we want this expression to make sense. But if G is not differentiable at f of x, then this expression has no meaning.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Similarly.
Yes, sir. Okay. We need to really understand that. I'm accepting that. they can sweep in kind of the superfluous understanding that, okay, this means change of. Alright, so here's the proof. So the proof is pretty much simple. Okay? As simple, but you know, interesting. So here is the notation. So he said that like y is f of x. So the root is that like y is f of x. And just think about it. I am interested in what? Interested in one of the thing, which is, for example, f of t minus f of x over t minus x. Difference of f prime of x. So it's like I want to make them zero, so that you can have this equality. So are they zero at the moment?
No, sir.
So their difference should be something. So it should be function of what? Function of what? Which is arbitrary element here?
These are arbitrary.
We can do anything. Okay, let's assume that.
X comma t.
So it's like, okay. So we gave this difference a name actually, which is root. And similarly, I have something g of s minus g of y over s minus y. I would like to take its difference from, obviously, g prime of y. So it's like that's an average value, that's instantaneous value, and I want both to converge to each other, and let's call this difference as, for example, g of s. Okay? Where t lives in a to b, and s is in the interval I, because g is evaluating. If g is evaluated at s actually, and g is defined on I, so I, s should be in I.
Between f of a and f of
b. S. No. I can have more points than f of a and f of b. And we haven't assumed that f of a and f is an increasing function. What do you mean by when you are saying that f is between f of b? Are we assuming that f is increasing? So it's arbitrary. So that's a very abstract kind of a function. Okay, so you have this. Now, what will happen in this definition if I say that t goes to x?
So why are we just saying that t belongs to a to b? Why don't we say that x belongs to a to b?
Where?
Here. So we are saying t belongs to a to b and s belongs to I.
Uh-huh.
We can also say that x belongs to a to b and y belongs to I.
No, it's your choice that how you want to
represent
it. X is a fixed number. X is a fixed number. So you can fix t and you can say, okay, you can make x arbitrary, it doesn't matter. Then obviously you have to change these arguments. Anyway, so what will happen if t goes near to x actually?
So u of t becomes 0.
So this is going to imply that if t goes to x and s goes to y, this is going to imply then that u of t goes to 0, and v of s goes to 0. Agree?
Yes, sir.
This is something that we have.
By the differentiability of f and g, right?
By the
differentiability
of f and g. That's what we have also assumed.
Yes.
That's what we have also assumed. Now, I would like to come to the real matter. We are happy with this?
Yes, sir.
That's the basic stuff. Now, I would like to come to the real matter, which is, say for example, h of x. Maybe h of t minus h of x. X is a map from where to where?
A to B.
G of I.
G of I, or maybe you know, somewhere in R.
Yes.
So obviously this T's and X are from here. B is. So what is going to be H of T minus H of X? So this is going to be G F of T. So it's like a G composed with F of T.